Very good morning, one and all. First of all, I would like to thank the coordinator of this Atal FDP, Dr. Junaid, and the management of Lords Institute of Engineering Technology Hyderabad, and of course the Atal Academy for organizing a wonderful event from the Atal series of in the thrust areas. So that is one among is 3D printing. So I would like to also thank the AACTE, especially for the Atal scheme. So then a very good morning, one and all. I'm going to say talk on the title will be on the applications of 3D printing in aviation industry. Why aviation industry is so popular using this 3D printing technology. So my focus will be, so this is going to be the outline of my presentation. So I thought this is the first session. So then let me put some introduction to the 3D printing technology. So that's what I'm going to start with, some introduction to 3D printing technology. And then how the 3D printing is also called as additive manufacturing. So how it will differ from the conventional manufacturing process. So then we'll, and especially aerospace industry, what are the advantages that you come to the additive manufacturing over the conventional manufacturing processes? And then what is 3D printing is all about, and the various steps involved in the 3D printing process and general applications. Now, other speakers is going to talk on these applications, but I want to give a glimpse of the general applications, and our talk will be focusing on the aviation case studies and the benefits to the aviation industry by using this 3D printing technology. And any technology, material is going to play a vital role. And what are the materials that the aviation industry is looking for? And then, of course, then we have several challenges of this 3D printing technology. So we are going to talk about the challenges of 3D printing technology, and finally giving the future direction of this 3D printing technology. So that's what I have planned for the next 1.5 hour of my talk. So let us review the industrial revolution. So right now we are in the industry fourth, that is fourth industrial revolution called Industry 4.0. Just we can recollect the previous industrializations. So right from the first industrialization, that is during 1780s to 1860, where mechanization was coined during that period. So that was called as first industrial revolution, or otherwise called as Industry 1.0. So where the steam energy was the major energy source. Of course, the steam and water was the energy sources, and you have a mechanical production systems which the muscle power is replaced with the machines. That's what the mechanization was the coined term during first industrial revolution. And then coming to the second industrial revolution, that is 1870s to 1960, where steam and water energy is replaced with electrical power. And of course, the assembly lines as came into picture to make it, the assembly will be more simplified or more in automated way. So then you have a better version of machines working independently. Then you have the assembly lines concept came into picture during second industrial revolution. And coming to third industrial revolution, it is very much popular because of computers and because of the automation. So automation was the coined here during third industrial revolution. So that is between 1970s to 2010. So where you have information technology, computers, and electronics and automation was the major players during third industrial revolution. So then what about the current fourth industrial revolution, otherwise called as industry 4.0? So you may have autonomous systems now is going to play a vital role, and cloud computing systems, system integration, simulation studies,
Yeah, I think there is a
Hello. Yeah, hello.
Yes, sir.
Am I audible now?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, so where we have stopped somewhere here, right? So I think, so
4.0,
this we have completed, or I don't know whether we have.
No, sir. That.
Okay, fine. Simulation. Okay, fine. Right. Thank you. Yeah, coming to the industry 4.0, so where you have the cutting edge technologies like autonomous systems, cloud computing, system integration, simulation, and IoT, that is Internet of Things. And you have augmented reality, virtual reality is another thrust area under Industry 4.0. And you have a big data analysis and cyber security. So you have a blockchain for securing the data and cyber security systems. So these are the cutting edge technologies under Industry 4.0. And of course, Atal Academy is also focusing on these, say, thrust areas, nine thrust areas. So coming to the, what could be the manufacturing under this Industry 4.0? So we know the other simulation tools, and we know the computer technology, communication technology, but what about the manufacturing under Industry 4.0? So then, being a mechanical engineer, so then we are very much familiar, like which you have the third industrial revolution. You have a CNC technologies, robotics are playing a vital role. Even the additive manufacturing as introduced in even in the third industrial revolution, but with the name as a rapid prototyping, that was the name previously, but now it got the elevation, or it got more maturity in terms of the technology. So that's what now it got promoted into a manufacturing status. So under Industry 4.0, undoubtedly the manufacturing is getting shaped from conventional subtractive nature to the additive nature. That's what we are here, like 3D printing or additive manufacturing technology. So that is going to change the face of the manufacturing scenario. So then several studies are saying that it's going to be the, say, ABS, ABI research. So they have projected that. So it's going to be, additive manufacturing is going to be a 2 trillion worth parts is going to getting fabricated, and end products. So the underlying thing is, it's the end product, means it's the direct usage of these products, that, and which is right apt to our title in the aviation industry, how these gas turbine engine parts, or how the structural elements, or the cabin parts. So then that's going to be the end product. So it's not about the prototype, it's not about the model. So it's going to be the end products by 2030. So $2 trillion worth of US dollar is going to be the projection by this the ABI research survey. And you can see several surveys which it is saying that additive manufacturing, otherwise called as 3D printing, is going to play a major role under Industry 4.0, or the fourth industrial revolution. So then further exploring the additive manufacturing technology, so then we need to compare with the conventional existing systems, and what extra you are going to get out of this additive manufacturing. So that is the thing, most important thing which we need to know about this technology, right? So until unless you doesn't have a benefits of this technology, so then it is not advisable to adopt this technology at your industry or at your organization, right? So then let us focus on the classification first. The traditional classification of manufacturing processes. So as we know that we are very much familiar about the subtractive process, like CNC or any machining technology, so that you're going to use the tools in order to remove the material, so which is taken in a bulk form, and then so by making use of the tools, so continuously you will be removing the material from the raw material to the finished part. So you're going to get a huge scrap, and we need to design jigs fixers. So depending on the complexity of the product that you're going to machine, right? So, and one more important thing is, if I change my design from a simple step structure, step design, to a a kind of a free form coffee cup kind of design, say. So if at all, if you want to machine this coffee cup through CNC technology, so what are all the constraints that we need to work on? The first constraint that we need to work on, the cavity is too deep here. So then how do you approach your tool? So imagine that you're going to start with a bulk of material. So then block of material that you are going to start and keep on removing the material by using the various tools. So then we need to perform this operation, right? And then you have an undercut here. So because of this undercut, minimum it requires a three-axis machining center we require. And in order to hold from the bottom, so we need to design and fabricate a fixture. So that should be, say, fixed from the bottom of your workpiece. And then you have a very sharp internal feature here, which cannot be machined otherwise without a tool radius compensation. So with these constraints, we need to, say, proceed for your CNC practice. So that is coming under a subtractive method. But same thing if you want to perform through additive manufacturing. So you require only the CAD model of this. So you need only the digital model of this, the product that you are going to fabricate. So just you get the digital model and everything will be done automatically. So there is no tool, there is no jig, there is no fixer. So there is no compensation or a kind of thing normally you do with the CNC practice, and without writing a G code, M code, so you are able to, say, get this kind of part. So then what do you mean by an additive manufacturing? Is like your product is getting discretized into number of layers, and one layer upon other layer it is getting adding. So means it is an additive process rather than a subtractive process. You can save a lot of scrap in terms of scrap. So there is no scrap at all here. That is huge benefit for an aerospace industry. So then we'll explore that. So then we have to have only the CAD model, and then rest of the things will be automatically, it will be done. And it is going additively, means it is joining the material layer by layer, irrespective of your design complexity or irrespective of your, say, geometry, it is getting fabricated. And of course, you may have other class of manufacturing which will be a formative in nature, something like your injection molding, die casting, or sand casting, which we need to make some die. So that die, so in case of a formative process, so we need to make a die of that shape of the part that we are looking at. So then again, this die may be again made through a subtractive process. Then whatever the constraints that we are talking about, so all are applicable here also. So then what I'm trying to say here is, if you are coming to additive manufacturing route, so neither a die nor a tool is needed. So it is a toolless, it is a die-less, and it is a fixture-less manufacturing. So that's about the additive. Then we will explore further. So then immediately, next point that will come to your mind will be, what could be the cost of the technology or the cost per part? So if you plot the curve between the part per cost per part versus the number of parts, and which you can, once the number of parts are increased, so we can get more advantage in terms of cost reduction in case of a conventional formative process as well as subtractive process. So that very much you can get the advantage of mass production or producing a good number where you can reduce your cost. But whereas you have a peculiar behavior of additive manufactured parts, the cost of additive manufactured parts that is almost like a straight line, so, and maybe sloping downwards slightly. But then what is the advantage of this, right? So that's what which you can talk about. So then definitely, let me introduce the the other parameter here is the complexity. Say I have a part something like this, which is of a standard cylindrical and circular and some fillet features which are there here. So then immediately you have changed your design from this simple design to a complex design. So your designer has changed from this to this because he needs to get more performance of this existing system, and he has redesigned into a bionic design or a nature inspired design, so which is of more performance than the previous design. So then how do you get fabricated this design? So then what could be the cost difference between your previous design to the new design? So if it is a formative or a subtractive process, so anyway it may go two times or three times of the previous cost of for this design. You have X rupees of cost, and because of the design change, it may go 2X rupees or 3X rupees. But if you use additive manufacturing from this design to this design, so it may be X plus delta X rupees. So it's not costing you. So you may have, hello? Hello? Yeah, but some disturbance is coming. That's what. Yeah. Hello. Okay. So then we are talking about the complexity. So then, if you use an additive manufacturing or 3D printing, so the geometric complexity with increasing in functionality, the functional performance, so the manufacturing at it is virtually no additional cost. Otherwise, we can put it, the complexity is a free of cost here. Then how do you justify this statement, the complexity is a free of cost with additive manufacturing? So if you take a typical components, which is of, say, if you take a die, so this die consists of, say, some injection molding die. So which you can see this die consists of this kind of complex design. And if you see the heat carried away by, so you have the coolant, normally you have the injection mold and you have the coolant will be pumping inside. So if my cooling channel, if I could be able to do it through a conventional manufacturing process, I can drill only the straight channel, but I cannot drill conforming to my the shape and size of the part. That's the meaning of a conformal cooling channel, which is you have as for the geometry. So as for the geometry, the shapes which you could even able to say design your cooling channel, which is confining to the shape of the complex part. So that is the beauty. So then your additive manufacturing is not going to cost you any extra money. So which you can see the same discussion if you want to continue from the previous slide. So cost versus complexity. So because of this complexity, your conventional manufacturing process may go two times or three times extra. It may be X rupees previous design, and now it may be a 4X or 3X, which you can see there is an exponential increasing in the cost because of the complexity. But whereas, again, you can get the advantage of additive manufacturing, the cost remains same if your complexity is increased. So that's what where the beauty of this additive manufacturing or 3D printing technology will come into picture. So it is quite apt for the aerospace industry. Why? Because your aircraft parts, either it is a structural parts or underhood parts, or it may be cabin parts, or it may be any fuselages, all are aerodynamic in nature. So which is a very complex in nature, right? So whenever you have a complexity, so additive manufacturing or 3D printing will take happily. So that is the mantra of this additive manufacturing under these circumstances. If you talk about any complex object like aerospace industry, then we will come to that, how it is getting benefited the aero industry by using additive manufacturing technology. So then if you try to choose among the lot, say the decision curve, or like say you have the 3D printing technology and you have a CNC machine and you have investment casting and you have injection molding technology. So then which technology will give you the best situation or the selection of your, say, the technology selection? So if you draw the graph between complexity versus quantity, of course, so whenever you have highly complex products, relatively looking at less number, undoubtedly 3D printing will give you the cost-wise justification rather than any other conventional CNC or formative process like molding or casting, right? And whenever you have the complexity is medium and relatively you're looking a medium quantity of the product, number of product that you're going to fabricate, relatively it is medium. So the CNC technology will give you the right solution for that. And then whenever you're looking for say less complex and looking at a huge number, so then of course investment costing is going to give a good solution for that case. And then coming to the complexity is medium and still you're looking at a very high quantity, so the injection molding may be the better solution under these circumstances. So with this keeping in mind, so further you will explore not only this, why additive manufacturing? So up to now, whatever you are discussing, so it may not be much encouraging in terms of any industry, but we'll explore further, especially the aviation industry, how it is going to be. And before that, what is a 3D printing is all about? So as I already said that you have this technology formerly known as a rapid prototyping. So that was introduced in 1984-85. So that is during even third industrial revolution, but it was with a different name. It was coined in the third industrial revolution. That's called as a rapid prototyping. So now it got elevated technological developments. So it has given a promotion to a manufacturing technology. That's what now you are no more prototyping. So it may be an additive manufacturing, and further it is extension of a two-dimensional printing. So otherwise called as, it's also called as a 3D printing. So the more appropriate name as an engineer, of course, additive manufacturing may be the right word that you can cultivate this habit to use additive manufacturing rather than 3D printing. Why? Because 3D printing is a common name. It's a layman terminology. So you may use a 3D printing, but being an engineer and that you're a mechanical engineer, so the preferred name for this technology is additive manufacturing. Anyway, you name this technology either rapid prototyping, additive manufacturing, 3D printing, but the essence will be same. Then we need to start with the CAD model, so which is derived from either a CAD CAM CAE software, or either it can be a digitized to a 3D digitizers or a 3D scanners in a reverse engineering practice. So then there also you will get the digital data, or even it can be a medical space where you can get a CT or a MRI scan data. That is also digital data. So let it come to any form, either medical route or 3D scanning route or a CAD-CAM CAE practice. So then your CAD model is essential. It doesn't bother whether you have derived from a medical systems or a scanning systems or a CAD-CAM software. So then the data is ready, which is derived from any one of these forms. So then what next? So the next will be, so then we need to say start with your CAD model, so which is derived from your either one of these methods which we discussed previously, either through CAD-CAM software or reverse engineering, or even it can be a medical data. But in this case, I want to sip a coffee. So my application will be to sip a coffee. So then I need to make a coffee cup. So in order to make a coffee cup, so then I can go to any CAD software. Nowadays, even Android-based CAD-CAM software is also available. That too, it is an open source software. So making a CAD model under these circumstances, it is not a tough job for anybody to come out with a CAD model. So then once you get that CAD model, and then we need to convert that CAD model into an STL file. So STL file is a triangular mesh. So that triangular mesh, which it is a neutral format rather than it, which a 3D, any 3D printer or any additive manufacturing machine can understand STL file, but the 3D printer cannot understand a .prt or a .prt, say SLD PRT or .ASM files, but it should be recognized only with an STL file. So in that's the reason we need to save this model as an STL file. So once you convert your model in STL file, so then you have an interfacing software, so which is connected with these machines. So that software will take this STL file, just you import this STL file to this interfacing software. So in that software, so you do after transferring your data, STL data, and you prepare a machine setup. So that machine setup is nothing but something like your G code, M code in case of a CNC, but you are not writing any G code, M code here. So as for your design, and once you select the process parameters, if it is a laser system, you specify the laser parameters and you specify the layer thickness. Why? Because it's going layer by layer. You specify the layer thickness, you specify the all other process parameters, orientation, hatch space. You have plenty of parameters, process parameters. So just you can specify those parameters. If you are not specifying also, your software will take by default some parameters. You need not much worry about, but one can understand how your process parameters are affecting on the quality of the part by keeping in mind that. So then you can choose your process parameters and then you can generate a machine setup. So that machine setup in terms of a layers or the cross-sectional data, so that will be sent to the machine. So in this machine, exactly how your digital data is layer by layer, how it is got generated. So physically the same code is getting realized here to fabricate the one layer upon another layer. So then depends on what kind of technology and what kind of raw material you are using it, whether it is a metal, polymer, ceramic, composite, or it may be a living cells, or even it can be any material that your machine can able to take up that, and then your process will start from layer by layer. Then once you complete all the layers, so then you have come out with your final product that it should be removed from the machine. So the removal of the product from the substrate or from the platform, we need to detach your part. And then once you remove that, and then sometimes we need to clean, sometimes we need to remove the supports, and sometimes we need to even do some kind of a furnace treatment. So then you, based on your application. So in this case, my application is simply to sip a coffee. So it may not require much post-processing methods here, but you have another side. I have a turbine blade. I have a jet engine part. So then how do you ensure that all my properties, the fractional properties or the mechanical properties and the microstructural properties, so that are coming or not, right? Say in that case, even you may use some kind of furnace treatment or some kind of hipping or short pinning. So you do a several post-processing methods. So finally, you can improve your the product, say mechanical properties, dimensional properties, further you can improve it from as built to the final product. So then you may use some post-processing methods depending on upon your application, whether it is simply to sip a coffee or to fly an aircraft. So then that's the matter, the what kind of a post-processing method and what kind of a material that you are going to use for this additive manufacturing technology, right? So with this background, let us move on to the next slide. So then in continuation with my discussion, like you have the material, say that it can take up polymers, again thermoset or thermoplastics can be taken, thermoset can be taken, amorphous can be taken, semi-crystalline can be taken, and metals and metal alloys and ceramics, it can be now taken, the ceramic materials, and of course composites can also be 3D printed. And then apart from these standard four materials, even it can be a functional material like electronic or shape memory material, or even it can be a biological material like a tissue or like skin or like a stem cell or a blood cell. Even it can be a biological material, which is a natural material rather than. So then it can be a food or it can be an any material of your choice. So then you have a huge flexibility in terms of material choice. And then what could be the form of material that you are looking at? So either it can be a powder, granulated powder, maybe 30 to 50 micron size, maybe an filament, or it's in a wire, maybe 1.75 mm diameter or a 3 mm diameter filament, or it can be a rod of a quarter inch or a half inch rod. It can be in that form, or even it can be a laminate or a sheet, the raw material form maybe, or even it can be a liquid in form. So you can start your 3D printing raw material maybe in any one of these forms. And then coming to the various AM processes, so then recently ASTM has standardized this into 7 groups. So I'm not going to explore all this, and the standards I'm going to take up in tomorrow's class. So then I'm not discussing as of now here about the standards, certification, qualification, and other stuff. But the ASTM and ISO has come out with standardizing this terminology and the processes, all that they have done by using ISO ASTM standards. So in order to standardize this technology, so they have done that. So, and then coming to the applications of 3D printing, say, technology. So then you have right from the consumer products, consumer electronics, say something like you are making some grippers or making from RFID devices for electronics and embedded electronics. So then you have a huge potential for this kind of a consumer products or consumer electronics, which we can see this is around 370 million US, European euros. It is 370 million euros of revenue that has been generated through this consumer products and consumer electronics applications. And coming to the automobile, so it is 320 million euros in terms of revenue that is generated through an automobile industry, either in terms of visual prototypes or presentation models or special components for motorsports, for Formula One, or maybe some luxury cars. So maybe cooling ducts for that automobile applications. And you have medical and dental, the revenue is around 280 million euros, that is in terms of dental bridges, copings, crowns, caps, and invisible braces. And of course, customized prosthetics, implants. So that is about the medical. But anyway, I'm not going to talk about all these applications. But our focus will be on this sector, that is an aerospace sector. So then coming to the aerospace sector, so this is also giving a good revenue, that is 180 million euros in terms of. So the biggest advantage of 3D printing in aerospace, so you can make a lightweighted parts, that is a huge in complexity. The geometric complexity is huge in terms of a fuel nozzle, for example. So it's complex, the geometrically it's very complex. And the other requirement is lightweight, it should be more lightweighted. And then you have even a stationary turbine component. So you have a gas turbine engine inside your, you have a turbine engine. So in order to propel your aircraft, so then you have the turbine, the stationary turbine parts, or even people are reworking for the burners, for the turbine components. So then we'll explore further about this aerospace applications. And even you have a tools molds, that is for say, in terms of investment casting, or in terms of say injection molding or sand casting, sand molds. So then you have a 230, say, million euros of revenue in terms of, say, manufacturing inserts, tools, molds for cooling channels. And then you have a direct toolings for either in terms of, say, direct tools or indirect tools for like making a master pattern. And further, you're going to make the final part by using that as a master pattern. So that is called indirect tooling. So coming to the tooling industry, that is also promising. And other industries, like you have several other industries. I hope the other speakers are going to exclusively talk on these some of the applications like military, architecture, oil and gas. You have another and space, of course. And you have the consumer products for customization of designed objects, or even you have jewelry applications, food printing, construction. You have huge potential under other industrial applications. So let us focus our business for at this point of time onto this aerospace applications. So then coming to the aerospace, why aerospace is looking for an AM technology? So of course, the AM is almost the verge of the maturity for the industrial manufacturing. It's a huge life cycle saving potential for aircraft. So, but don't see as a product, but you see entire life cycle, means right from the conceptualization, design, production, and in service. So if you talk about an aircraft, so the typical life of an aircraft is around 25 to 30 years. So if you consider entire life cycle of 25 years of aircraft that it is under before retirement, so then you see in that angle, so then what are the potential benefits that you are going to get? So in terms of a huge life cycle saving potential for the aircraft engines, especially I am talking in this slide about the aircraft engine parts and the aircraft engine industry exclusively I'm talking about. So then why additive manufacturing? Of course, so if you see the scenario of aerospace, so from 2003 onwards, so there is a huge potential for metal additive manufacturing. So the people like GE or Boeing, Airbus, Pratt & Whitney, Rolls-Royce, so all these guys, they are adopting the metal additive manufacturing as part of their, say, integral part of their design and the product life cycle, say, phases. And you have high quantity of additive manufacturing is needed for testing. As we know that you may wonder why this technology, is it be safe that the gas turbine engine parts are made through additive manufacturing? So it is not surprised to have some of the parts are additively fabricated while flying in your aircraft. But then what kind of certification, what kind of a qualification they have undergone, who has given the approvals for them, right? So then that also we'll discuss in the next second session, the standardization, qualification, and the certification. But during this talk, we'll focus our discussion to preliminary applications and the design aspects. So then you have a huge potential to use your either for your surprise, even fuselages also additively fabricated in the recent times. So one can understand you could be able to make a fuselage. So why not the other parts? Maybe a landing gear, or maybe your gas turbine components, or maybe the cabin parts, maybe the structural parts. So to name a few. So then what are the advantages that you are going to get out of this additive manufacturing in aviation? So you can quickly complete your certification and your clearances. Even it can be your entire product life cycle or entire product development time may be not less than 3 years that you are going to introduce a new generation of turbine, the new series of the jet engine into the market. So then you can even it may take even less than 3 years you could be able to introduce your new engine, the gas turbine engine or the aero engine that you're going to introduce. And then you have great potential fuel nozzles as anyway, we are going to explore some of the case studies. And then the huge potential here is light weighting. So you have a lighter weight structures. Why? Because it has inspired from the nature inspired designs, so which you can make a light weighted structures, and you have more less carbon emission or carbon dioxide emissions, or less if you compare with the conventional things. And not only the light weighting, so it will even enhance the fuel consumption. So you can save a lot of fuel once you have this light weighted structures. So that is the beauty of this technology under aircraft industry. So then you may have even light weighting. You're talking about weight reduction. So then how matters this weight reduction in terms of aero industry, right? So then if you talk about the traditional buckle, so these, I think, I hope everybody might have touched this kind of buckle. So that is made out of a steel initially, and it was weighing around 155 grams. And then they have shifted from steel to the aluminum. The aluminum, it may be weighing around 120 grams. So that is the weight reduction. And then if you could able to integrate your, say, additive manufacturing, so in terms of light weighting, in terms of topology optimized structures, or which is bio-inspired structures, so which it could even from 120 grams to 70 grams because of the design and because of the material that you are going to use. So you are going to use a titanium instead of aluminum. So, and then you may use instead of a solid buckle, and you may use say topology optimized buckle, which is a more light weighted. So then you could even able to reduce 55% weight. So can you imagine that if you take any a typical Airbus 380, so you have around 853 passengers, means you have an economy seating, which is of capacity 853 seats. So then each seat, each buckle, it is costing you maybe around 70 grams of weight. So then one can imagine that, so you could be able to save 72 kg. So 72 kg savings from the initial design to the standard buckle design to the additive manufactured or the topology optimized buckle, so which it is saving 72 kg. So a typical statistic saying that, so you have 3.3 million liters of fuel, so that is approximately, so 2 million European currency, so which could save. So means what I'm trying to say, if you take the entire life cycle or the lifetime of this flight, so as I said, it is typically 25 years. So then it is going to say 45,000 liters of fuel, it is getting saved, right? So then don't think that a simple buckle design, how it is getting impacted on the performance or on the cost wise. So then if you want to go with the traditional machine, then you go, but then additive manufacturing, you're going to get a double benefit in terms of fuel saving. The that is the beauty of this technology. Don't omit this technology. It's saying that only it is saving only the 70 grams of weight. So then one can just, I want to emphasize the importance of the light weighting structures in aircraft industry. That's my idea. So anyway, you can find several, say 3D printed, say prototypes, or maybe fitment and assembly or functional models. So maybe the entire, say aero engine parts, maybe a cut section of this for maybe for some prototyping applications, or even it can be an unmanned aerial vehicle, which is of a smart wings. So which is say for these are additively fabricated. So these wings, smart wings rather than. So then even the fuselage, and you have the fuselage to wing connection. So this is say the CAD design, and further it is getting printed through a stratasys. So you have a light weighting like Altem or a Peak as the material, which is of a more strength to weight ratio. So these structures are getting printed through additive manufacturing, or even it can be the inside the cabin or inside the pilot, say cockpit. So then you have several parts that is additively fabricated now. So now you can even have some of the so toroidal housings that are used in an aircraft. So which you can see, this is again an Altum material. This is a polymer, which is of high strength to weight ratio. So which you can be see that there is a huge potential that instead of conventional, very thin walled structures, there is a huge wastage, or even it is a die casting. So then, or it is a injection molding. So then you need to invest a huge towards in the tooling cost. But here, just you can use a polymer extrusion based system. So which it can be cost wise also, it can be justifiable, right? So in that way, which you can even use this additively fabricated, say toroidal housings, or it can be a satellite assembly, which you can see, this is a satellite assembly, which would have the electronics also in it. So which you can see on the right side, so these are additively fabricated, these are satellite, say internal components, or even it can be a kind of, say for unmanned aerial vehicle, there are some, say what you call, you have some of the parts which are there in inside your aircraft. Or even the beauty here is you can make say part consolidation, means this was the previous design which it consists of some 10 parts, but all the 10 parts made it as a single part. Now the part consolidation has happened because of additive manufacturing, so all the 10-12 parts are made it as a single part. The part consolidation is another advantage once you come to the additive manufacturing for your aerospace applications. Even it can be, one can imagine, so how it could be conventionally fabricate this kind of bio-inspired or a nature-inspired geometry or the structures that it's getting. So either in terms of say brackets, or in terms of say you can see all these parts, so which is of more light-weighted structures because of bio-inspired or topology-optimized structures than the traditional solid designs. And you have very thin-walled combustion chambers, so that is there inside the, say, your aircraft engine. So you have very thin-walled structures, so you have 89 or 90% scrap if you go with the conventional machining of this part in a nickel based alloy like Inconel 718. So that is again a costly affair. You don't have a luxury to say letting 90% is a scrap by using either an Inconel or a titanium or aluminum. So that is very a huge say savings in terms of so additive manufacturing if it's used very thin walled structures like this, right? And of course, you can make direct parts for your engine parts for impellers or all these, or the blades, turbine blades, all these are additively fabricated. One can understand the aerodynamic shape, the geometry, how come, why, because it is in, say, aerofoil geometry. So it is very tough to conventionally do with a huge scrap, or maybe casting, you may have several challenges, defects, the casting defects, and so on and so forth. So then these are some of the direct parts that are additively fabricated through, say, for aircraft industry. And of course, GE, as I already said, this is a LEAP engine. They have, initially it was 20 parts, the previous design. Now the 20 parts, they made it a single part now. And you have 19 nozzles per LEAP engine they are going to use in a single engine. So then it is 5 times durable than the previous design, and 25% weight reduction. So that is what, where you are going to get the benefit. Why these aviation industry is looking for 3D printing or additive manufacturing. So even it can be in a combustion chamber, so one can understand the temperatures that it's going to have at the combustion chamber. So then these are the additively fabricated parts, and not only the say engine parts, even it can be a structural parts, like which you can use a bionic design, means nature inspired design. You can make more lightweighted structures. Companies like Airbus, Boeing, so they are looking these kind of solutions for bio inspired designs, which is a 15% lighter space than the previous traditional designs. And this is another case study from GE Aviation. So this is 1/3 of their engine parts in a typical aircraft engine. So they made through additive manufacturing or 3D printing. So they have started this project in 2015. And recently they got the certification from the Aviation Authority. So they got certified now. It can be now flown in the air. So then that's the kind of development, the additive manufacturing and the aviation industry, it got such kind of link. And the benefits, it's a simplified supply chain logistics, right? So if it is conventionally machined or conventionally casted, so we need to search for a huge supply chain, huge say logistics involved to fabricate conventionally. But simplified assemblies because of part consolidation and simplified maintenance and weight savings, that is a huge potential savings. So in terms of aero industry is concerned, and improved fuel burning efficiency 20% and 10% more power. So the performance of the system is also improved. Not only the cost, in terms of performance of the system is also now improved, right? And even it can be a monolithic thrust chambers with an say conformal cooling channels, even it can be internal cooling structures, even it can be a lattice structures. So which we can see, you have the fuel injector and you have a thrust chamber and you have this lattice structure, which will improve the efficiency or the performance in terms of heat carrying capacity. So it will be because of the lattice structure or the bionic, bio-inspired design, so which can improve the cooling efficiency. And not only improving the efficiency, it will become a lightweighting structure. And then previously they used to use a CNC machining to say machine Inconel 718, that is a nickel based super alloy. Now they are using additive manufacturing for making this kind of complex aerospace rockets. And of course, heat exchangers is another area where you can further explore the bio-inspired designs in order to improve the cooling efficiency, right? The heat carrying efficiency, the performance of the heat exchanger in terms of a lung inspired or in terms of a lattice structure or a cellular structure, which can improve the performance as well as the lightweighting. And you can have a traditional manufacturing, which is of a bigger size, but you can have more compact within the less space you could accommodate in aerospace industry. That's about within the less space, lightweighting and the performance. So you're going to get a triple benefit out of this additive manufacturing than the conventional methods, right? Even you can now with the recent advancements, even copper can also be 3D printed. So as we know that the copper is the best conductor in the universe and the best design in the universe is the nature inspired design, that is a bionic design. So then if you could club the best design in the universe and the best material in the universe, you will get still wonders, right? So that's the power of this technology in aerospace. And you can even see lightweighting, not only if you see this structure, it was initially traditionally casted, so it is 5.1 kg and the functional surface area, it may be around 823 cm³. And whereas with the additively manufactured lattice structures, so the weight is reduced from 5.1 kg to 1.9 kg. So not only weight reduction, you can see the functional surface area. So it is 10223. So which we can see how much improvement in terms of the efficiency or the performance of the system with the increasing of your surface area, working area. So because of this additively fabricated lattice structures, right? So that is the wonder, this technology under these circumstances, right? And even it can be, say you have a RF antennas. So this is a single part, but the traditional design was say 100 parts and they used to do a brazing EDM, and it used to take 8 months to develop this entire 3D, say, antenna, RF antenna. But now they made it very simplified. So 100 parts they made as a single part, right? And a few weeks, so 8 months to only 1 week or 2 weeks, it is getting reduced the product development time. And huge savings, 95% weight reduction. So that is very much needed for an aero industry. And then 20% reduction of production cost and 75% of non-recurring costs, so which is getting eliminated. So one can understand the importance of this technology under the aerospace. And which even you can see these, design of the wings, so which it can be further, say, optimized your aerodynamic efficiency by incorporating the lattice structures in your wings. So that is further, improving the performance of the system, right? That's wonderful, right? So not only that, even you can make your cabin structure or your fuselage structure into a lattice structure, which you can even further. So taking the inspiration from the nature, so without compromising the strength and the stiffness, of course, that is the beauty of this topology optimized structures. Without compromising your functionality, so you have a better performance. That is the beauty of this kind of design philosophy, either you call topology optimization or a bionic designs or a generative designs. So, but generative design altogether is a different philosophy. But so these are the bionic designs or the lattice structures or the topology optimized structures. So those are very much promising in aerospace industry. And how do you get fabricated? So designing aspect is one side. And then how do you get fabricate this kind of cellular or lattice structures? So that is the crux here, right? So additive manufacturing or 3D printing is going to be the solution for this kind of thing. And not only the aircrafts, even it can be as satellite parts. So then one can understand the stringent requirements of the materials. Why? Because it is a satellite. Then there will be a temperature maybe varying all the way to negative temperatures to a positive temperature. There is a huge temperature differences from your system to the environment, right? So then one can understand the importance of this kind of properties of these materials. So then we'll slowly come talk about the materials and the material aspects of this. So of course, so the design aspect is again a straightforward. This is a topology optimized structure. So rather than the conventional solid traditional design, which is more weight, rather than take it in a design space. So by using a topology optimized philosophy, then you can divide into design space and non-design spaces. And then finally you can so come out with the best design. So then you can even have a kind of design here, which is topology optimized designs. And then the material here, they use a titanium is the material choice here. Even it can be further lightweighted. Then with this, which you can satellite parts also directly, it is getting printed by using additive manufacturing technology. This is one of the Airbus case study which they have adopted. So then what are the advantages for the traditional manufacturing methods once you come to the additive manufacturing? So undoubtedly, then you can use premium materials. So utilization of the premium materials with little waste or zero waste, literally zero waste. Why? Because you are not removing the material, you are adding the material. So literally you are not wasting any material, and in turn it is giving you a cost savings, the huge cost savings, especially if you're working with the premium material, super alloys, right? Say then is a huge expensive materials. These are either you talk about Inconel or titanium, so aluminium, so it's very costly materials. So then you don't have a luxury to waste this material, right? So then you can have a huge potential towards cost saving and the material saving. So and then part consolidation, as we already discussed to the previous case studies, you have a fewer man hours required to assemble. Instead of 20 parts, you have a single part in case of a GE a LEAP engine that they have done for. So then you have a part consolidation, which is reducing the assembly time, assembly cost, right? So again, the another cost savings in terms of assembly cost. And you have an optimized geometry. So this is wonder. Why? Because you can have higher performance designs. Why? Because you have inspired the design from the nature. So then the traditional manufacturing processes may not able to produce these optimized structures, like in terms of lattice structures or in terms of, say, bionic structures. So then obviously traditional manufacturing methods may not, say, machine or may not produce. Then definitely you have an optimized geometrical advantage here. And lightweighting, of course, the last but not the least, the lightweighting of the components, which is, I have already given some statistics also with the fuel saving of a typical aero engine, so that we could be able to. There are a lot of huge fuel savings over the life of the project. So that's going to be the advantages. And you talk about the materials. So then you have titanium 64, titanium 6246, titanium 834. You can name the turbine, or you can name the engine parts, and you may use a different materials, and the hundreds or thousands of parts that is going into your gas turbine engine or in your aero engine, that it's going to be either a nickel based super alloy, titanium or aluminide. So you have huge potential to work, maybe from the GE or SpaceX. The SpaceX, you know, the SpaceX and their achievements, that's wonderful, right? And then even these the SpaceX or a GE or Airbus, so they may be much adaptive in these technologies because of these reasons. And then you name some of the materials and some of the application parts, either it can be an engine component or a cabin component or a structural component, any component. So if you talk about engine compartment, so in the engine compartment, so the example parts, maybe it can kind of nozzle bezels, so which is the, it requires a huge heat resistance, resistant function, and typically it will be done with an SLS. I think other speakers is going to explore about these processes. I am not going to concern about these processes, but you have a selective laser sintering that is comes under a powder bed system as for the ASTM standards. You have the material like a glass filled nylon. This is a composite material which it can perform such kind of a job. And cabin accessories, maybe a console control parts, or which is customized functional knobs, and SLA, which is of a standard resins, epoxy resins, photosensitive polymer resins will be used as a material. And then air ducts for airflow ducting, and its requirement is the flexible ducts, and it should have the bellow kind of a directors. So then you can use a nylon 12 using a selective laser sintering process from the powder bed systems. And then you have a full size panels for seat backs and the entry doors. And you have the requirement is a large parts with a smooth surface finish. And of course the SLA is going to give the best among the lot. So then you can use standard resins for do this job. And even some castable metal parts, like for say investment casting or for some kind of die making industry or the jigs fixers. So then you can use, say, for example, brackets on the door handles. So which probably you might have seen the previous. Hello, Dr. P. Ramesh, can you mute your mic, please? Hello. Yeah. And then you have a metal parts, and that is casted using a 3D printed patterns, and you may use SLA or a material jetting system for the material used is a castable resin or a wax. And coming to the metal components, like you have a suspension, say wishbone or GE jet engines. So they said like, so 1/3 part of their GE jet engines, they are making through metal 3D printed practice. And the requirements here is the lightweighting and the functional metal parts, and you have a GMLS or SLM powder bed metal systems, and the material typically used for a titanium or aluminum alloy that will be used for these kind of parts. And vessels, so then you have a dashboard interface for that. You have, or even from the customer screen vessels, these are some of the parts that you can, and material jetting may be used, and you have a digital ABS, maybe the material used for this. And even lights can also be, headlight prototypes can fully transparent in, so in nature, and high detailing models. So you can use either SLA or a material jetting system. So of transparent resins, which is a see-through kind of material properties, which you can get from these photosensitive resins. So these are some of the say example parts and where it can be used in aircraft, either it is an under the hood, that is in engine, aero engine, or it can be a cabin, or it can be a structural, or it can be a fuselage, or it can be a cabin part inside. So then you have a huge potential to use this. And let us talk about some of the advantages, of course, disadvantages, which we'll focus much now. So then you may have other side of the coin. So then what are all the disadvantages that additive manufacturing? So first of all, we'll summarize, or we'll explore the advantages in terms of general advantages, or in particular to the aero industry. So then you have freedom of design, as we already experienced this freedom of design in terms of topology optimized or nature inspired designs, which is of virtually, there is no shape constraint. So your designer, so which it, he or she can imagine. So then those are, there is no question of the producibility here. So whatever you imagine, so then that's a wonderful, which that may not be the case for the conventional machining or a casting process, right? And of course, the complexity is a free of cost. Even this we have been talking about. So then if you increase the complexity in your product, so your conventional manufacturing methods will put up more cost. But here it is negligible cost with delta X. So X plus delta X is going to be the thing there with the increasing complexity of your design. And you have potentially it is eliminating the tooling. There is no tool here. So then direct production is so possible without any costly or time consuming in case of tooling, to design the tool and fabricate the tools. So it will take minimum to minimum months scale, but not the weeks or but not the days scale in terms of the lead time I'm talking about. But here you don't have such kind of tooling at all here. So you can save a lot of time. And lightweight design, so that is the beauty, like which you can talk about topology optimized structures or lightweighting structures. So through FEA or a kind of topology optimized packages, which we can do a more lightweighting of structures, and that can be very easily fabricated. And part consolidation, as we already discussing, like the number of parts that in typical assembly, so it is got reduced. You have a part consolidation is another advantage, and elimination of production steps. Why? Because so it is going to be done in a single setup. So in case of a CNC, so then we need to check for number of setups and number of the kind of setups that you are going to make your final part. But this is in a single setup, so which eliminate your lot of production steps. So that is a beauty. And then talk about the disadvantages. What are the disadvantages that a typical, say, additive manufacturing system? So it's a slow build rates. So slow build rates, but still, say it is from the old school, that is a prototyping scenario, but still polymers, or it is four times faster than the previous generation machines, but metal printers are not that to that mark. But definitely build rates are not so great if you compare with the conventional methods. I'm talking about the machine and the material interaction. You take total life cycle time. It's all together a different ball game. But so anyway, you talk about the build rates, but still it is not up to the mark which you may be expecting. And then of course you may have high production costs, maybe for high cost of the material, especially the metal material polymers. Now it's very cheap. It's not that much costly than the previous one. But now you have the metal powders, maybe still it's costly. And you have considerable efforts which required for the application design for setting the process parameters. This is a major hell. Say you may have typically around 180 plus parameters that we need to optimize while designing and while generating your code. So then each part we need to do optimization of the process, a set of parameters. That is the huge hell of the job. And then manufacturing processes, like which it can have anisotropic properties, as we know that you cannot get an isotropic property. So, but then we need to bridge that gap. Then you may use a post-processing methods to here to enhance or getting closer to an isotropic property, surface finish and dimensional accuracy. So, but it may put more, say, cost because of the post-processing cost, which is involved. And discontinuous production processes, like so no integrity systems, which prevents the say economies of the scales. So that may be the another disadvantage. And limited component size, like still, but process like DED, so then you may have even bigger sizes. But it may not be true for all the seven categories of AM technologies. But some categories, even you can even make, say, 6 foot by 6 foot by 6 foot, so it can be gettable. But still, we can have a limited build volumes as far as metal printing, especially powder bed and other related technologies. But still, the limitation in terms of the build volumes, still we could quote. And lastly, then, what are the fabrication challenges that we can come across the 3D printing technology? As we start with the design, say you have, so the basic idea here is, so you have a complexity in terms of production process. What do you mean by that? Say you may have say challenges while setting the process parameters and while setting your say what you call your supports. For example, so you have a new concept of supports or overhangs. You have to take care about the overhangs. So that overhangs based on, again, our geometry. So then we need to tackle the support structures that is during the design. So that is a quite challenging for a design guy for additive manufacturing. So you have the concept of design for additive manufacturing. That is a huge subject to discuss. But anyway, so you have to have a kind of design rules or a set of design for additive manufacturing rules to come out with these challenges, making them, converting them into an opportunities also there. But we need to explore them, right? And of course, the materials, maybe the powder size still to handle, maybe 30 micron, 40 micron, and then powder purity, flowability. So you have some challenges as for the standards. Anyway, again, next second talk, I'm going to talk on the standards. We need to have some standards, ASTM standards, to come out while preparing your powders. And we need to, whether we need to have to that up to that mark. So then we need to question. And then the layout, like you have an horizontal, vertical orientations. The orientation is playing a vital role in case of your additively manufactured parts. And object proximity, and you have a chamber filling. How do you make use of your build chamber more effectively? So then these are some of the tips or the thumb rules for a design for additive manufacturing guy. So, and of course, coming to the process parameters, like if it is a laser system, so then what kind of a laser wavelength, laser power, scan speed. So you have several. So to name a few, these are the parameters, right? Around 180 plus parameters that is going to judge your accuracy, quality, and the material properties. So, and last but not the least, the post-processing methods. So something like heat treatment process, short peening, polishing methods. So these are the another aspects, what kind of post-processing method we need to. And you have several implications, and you may to have some constraints or some kind, something should be considered. So while fabricating your, say, especially metal parts I'm talking about. Say, what kind of a tension, a surface tension, curling effect, or the shrinkage problems. So then one can, normally whenever I give these lectures, people may ask some kind of research problems, right? So obviously you can explore these are the gaps where you can even do some kind of internal stress, or the internal stresses, how it is affecting your quality, right? Say you have a research problem, you can work out on, like, say, how it is getting flowability or your powder characterization and things like that, right? And even coming to the staircasing effect is a design aspect, which your design for A2 manufacturing guy should have to come out with, say, let's staircasing effect in order to improve the quality. And then volume contraction, the shrinkage or warpage, curling, all these things will come into picture, and which we need to have the other special attention towards this kind of thing, and heat dissipation. So then you have a huge temperature gradients, maybe 1000 degrees Kelvin, or maybe more than that, say per second, maybe. So then huge temperature gradients, then heat dissipation is a huge potential challenge. And then anisotropy in Z direction, why? Because it is building layer by layer in Z direction on the XY plane. So then you may have, feeble properties in Z direction compared with X and Y direction, the properties I'm talking about. And micro melting, so while changing the material properties. So then this is a huge challenge in front of additive manufacturing industry, or as a researcher, or as a technocrat or a bureaucrat by using this technology. So how these can be addressed, right? And then finally, then standardization. Anyway, I'm going to take a special class tomorrow. So then standardization, certification, and the qualification. So these are the things are lagging. So then you, if you have some standardized ASTM or ISO or European standards, then you can check your component against your, say, original made, whether it is as for the standard. So then we'll discuss thoroughly during my next talk. So, but there are lagging in terms of standardization and post-processing requirements is costing you more, the cost will be increased, and certification is lagging, and new potential hazards for, especially for the powder bed systems, and some VOCs will come, some respirators we need to keep, and then we need to have some kind of issues or challenges related to that kind of thing. And integrity of the digital data, and we need to even have some blockchain or cyber security systems to protect your digital designs, or to protect your IPs. So then that may be another challenge because of this disruption. Even it is disrupting your legal implications, or your cyber laws, or your copyright issues, right? So then we need to say debate, or we need to talk about these fabrication challenges. So let me conclude my talk by giving the future of the 3D printing technology. Of course, it may be which we have been experiencing 1D, 2D, 3D, and it may be the fourth dimension, or it may be a fifth dimension, but there is no fifth dimension. There is a gossip, which is a spread. This rumor has spread, but 4D printing is quite practical, and by the MIT, they have coined this technology. So which you have initially the 3D printed the structures, and it may become and more intelligent or more dynamic because of the shape memory materials, and because of the stimuli, and because of the mechanism of interaction. You do modeling and do simulate and do, and then your 3D printed structure is getting transformed, say by applying temperature, water, energy, or any stimuli for that matter. So it is getting transformed. So that is a wonderful, say, application, right? So even it can be a non-living application, or a life-saving, in case of a medical application, it may be a life-saving application once you talk about 4D printing. So then of course, which we can talk about the further scaling down of your parts, maybe a micro-sized or maybe a nano-sized products, can it be produced? Maybe produced in the future. And then you have self-healing microstructures and ball and socket. And then a battery. And nowadays, the automobile is EV driven. Say you have electronic vehicles. So can it be a battery? Can it be 3D printed? Some prototypes already done. Maybe in future, which we can integrate this technology with the battery technology, and it can be a combination of say analog and digital products. And finally, in future, it's going to be a voxel based printing. Means it's not going to be a layer by layer. Layered approach, you have several drawbacks like staircase and other aspects which we need to debate on that. But definitely you have an voxel printing, so which is of millions of voxels per second. So that's going to be the speed that it's going to print, or it's going to assemble these voxels in that's going to be the phase shift from the layer-wise printing to a voxel-based printing. So that's the kind of say projection people are going towards the future, transforming this technology into a voxel-based printing. So let me summarize what I have done for the 1 hour, 1.5 hour or so. So we have started our discussion with giving the importance of 3D printing under the Industry 4.0, that is the fourth industrial revolution. And we have thoroughly discussed the conventional versus additive manufacturing and the steps involved in additive manufacturing or 3D printing processes, and general applications we have discussed. And in elaborate, we have discussed aviation case studies and the benefits to the aviation industry and the materials, 3D printing materials in the aviation industry. And finally, we have discussed some of the fabrication challenges in 3D printing and given with the future direction of 3D printing. So, and then coming to the NIT, we are the first people to start an M.Tech additive manufacturing course, first time in India. So, and then we have set up a world-class the facility at NIT Warangal. We have metal 3D printing facility, that is DMP Flux powder bed system, and we have a couple of strata seismic polymer printing systems, and we have desktop based polymer printers, and we have a couple of scanners, and we have muffle furnace short pinning machine for post processing of these parts, and we have the softwares Mimics, Magix, Thrimatic, Catalyst, and 3D Expert to in connection with this the equipment and the softwares exclusively used for 3D printing applications. And say I think I have done from my side, and we have a YouTube channel also. I will be pasting the link in the chat box. If somebody is interested, even you can subscribe this YouTube channel. Yeah, it is over to you. Then if you are having some questions and interaction, I am very happy to answer those queries, which it will be, yes. Yeah, then I will be answering if at all there are some questions, and I'm very happy to answer those questions. Yeah.
Yeah, good afternoon, sir.
Yes. Yeah.
Sir, just I wanted to know about SLA, sir, stereolithography.
Mm-hmm.
LCD printers.
Okay.
Yeah, what are the opportunities for a researcher in SLA stereolithography?
Yeah, of course, LCD or a DLP based technology is very promising technology as far as transparency in the material is concerned, and it is the best accuracy among the polymer 3D printed parts is going to give. And most important, now it is a desktop in nature. The cost is very low now because of the open source, or because of the patents infringement has happened, the patents got expired. So then you have a huge demand for the SLA, that is DLP based technology, DLP or LCD based technology. So definitely you have these advantages. So you can even use this technology for making your basically wherever you are looking some polymers of epoxy resin, which is giving Then you tell me what is your application area, then I can suggest you whether how it can be applicable and what kind of work you are looking at. So then we can you elaborate your background and then what?
Yes, sir. I am looking for polymer composites.
Composites. Okay. Very good.
Yes, sir. Yeah.
Yes. Yeah. Yeah. You can, what you can do in that case is, so you can composites you are looking at.
Yes, sir.
So as far as composite, what kind of composite? It's a fiber, continuous fiber, or what kind of?
No, only particulate.
Okay. Okay. So if you are looking for some kind of a particulated composites, say, my advice will be not with the SLA. So okay. maybe you can try out with the FDM system than SLA. Why? Because SLA or DLP based technology, it will take a liquid as a raw material, epoxy resin.
Okay.
And if at all you can make some ceramics, you can try, but composites, with my exposure or my within my little knowledge what I have in the additive manufacturing, so definitely okay. If you are looking such kind of thing, maybe DM you can maybe the right choice, some extent rather than SLA. If you are looking some ceramic, definitely I prefer the DLP or LCD based technology.
Okay. Actually, many researchers are done extensive work in FDM, so fused deposition modeling. So just I wanted to continue with SLA as there are many advantages. We can control over the thickness we have.
Yes.
So
you have a laser here. You have a laser here. You can get that advantage. But how do you get say one thing is it should be a photosensitive material. So once you are talking about
it is a photosensitive material. One doubt I have about curing. So because we are adding reinforcement, it will be cured in the presence of reinforcement or not, I don't know. Why? Yes. Because it is a photosensitive material. So the bonding between monomers has to happen. If it reinforcement obstruct the bonding, then it will not happen. So that is the doubt I have, but there are many papers related to those. So just I wanted to asking my doubt to you, that's why.
Yeah, this is quite challenging, as you already said, like how it is getting your epoxy, that photopolymerization process getting, it may obstruct your say particles which it you have added.
Some of the researchers are telling that for a little amount of reinforcement you can add. Why? Because the reinforcement is at nano level, so that definitely if it homogenized mixture, then definitely the curing may happen.
You can make it a slurry and then you do it, and then but it's going to be very interesting if you continue in that direction. Why? Because it's not much of the people has attempted in that direction.
Yes, sir. That is my main intention. Why? Because everyone in the last 20 or 30 years, so many are focused on FDM, not on SLA. Why? Because SLA is not popularized because the technology is very costly and resins are not available at low price. And now it is becoming available to everyone. So just I wanted to start my work. I don't have much experience in that area, but I have knowledge from the literature only. So I have many doubts. So I wanted to clear my doubts. So I am asking you about this technology.
Yeah, okay.
Sir, even in FDM also we can give reinforcement at low weight fractions only, no, sir, because if we increase the reinforcement then it will become brittle. So the same case in SLA also we can give low volume weight fractions only because the bonding may not happen. That's why I want to continue with SLA. In FDM also we can try low weight fractions only. In SLA also we can try low weight fractions. So both are same, but coming to some advantages, are there some disadvantages?
Yeah, we can do otherwise some debinding and then followed by some sintering, some post-processing methods you can try.
Yeah,
and
sir.
Then
yeah, sir. Yeah, yeah, yeah. That's I want to try.
Yeah, yeah, you can try with that, say not as built. After building that, and then you can do some post-processing things.
Yeah,
done on
that. Yeah. You can so I asked. I asked a few people. Some of the researchers or some of the experienced person told that it is not possible. Some of the research person told it is possible if you are doing in that area also. So I am in dilemma. Actually, I am a part-time scholar from NIT Raipur.
Okay.
Yeah, sir. So I was in dilemma. So I am looking for experts.
No, definitely. You are going to be the first. You are going to be the person who is going to attempt. Very few people. You will become one among. But definitely, it can be gettable. Anyway, you are trying to do some research. So definitely, I cannot say outrightly it is not possible. But at the same time, I cannot say it is 100% possible. But anyway, research is all about some trial. So definitely you can, I have in my opinion, so it can be done. It can be done. So it's not, I cannot say it is impossible. It's possible. Okay. It's possible. Okay. It can be done.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much for your valuable suggestions and encouragement towards the research, to the researchers, those who are in additive manufacturing. Your efforts are definitely very motivational to all the researchers.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Yeah, any other questions or any other clarifications?
Hello. Good afternoon, sir.
Yeah, good afternoon.
Sir, so my question is about, so how can you how can we reduce the failure rates during the process? Because I'm dealing with FDM and SLM technology, so where we are facing few problems while processing the machine. So we are facing like support projections and in between machine stoppages, and as you mentioned that we can like about the applications and everything. So my question is about how can we reduce the failure rate? Because when I've gone through one research article, so there I have identified that because of designer errors and due to some inexperienced people, so the failure rate is about 10%. So what are all the precautions that we can take for reducing these 10%? So another question is, sir, so as you mentioned earlier in the PPT that we have a great applications in outer world, so I agree with that, but qualifying the product is a main difficult thing as of now that we are facing in aerospace applications. Because to qualify one material in aerospace to conduct a hot test, it is costing like everything. So whether how can we reduce that qualifying the part, and where we can save the money in that field, like qualification. So these are two my doubts, sir. One thing is failure rate, and how can we qualify with the lower cost?
Yeah, definitely. These two are interrelated questions. Whatever you put the asked two questions here. So the error or the failure rates and the qualification, all these two directly linked with the standardization of this technology. So anyway, I'm going to talk tomorrow exclusively on standardization, qualification and certification. But anyway, you ask the question, then I can say give you the answer. Right now it is unfortunately you don't have the standards. If you have some standards, so then you can compare every time against to that standard whether it is as for the standard or not, right? So the biggest challenge here is this technology started in 1988 commercially, and the standards recently the ASTM and ISO got say collaboration recently. They started standardization and qualification and certification giving these kind of things, but it is quite lengthy process also, as you already said. So it will take lengthy to give a somebody like say Federal Aviation Authority to get it clear for in the aviation application. So then GE and the ASTM, ISO, they formed some kind of user groups, and then they are working out. So, but still the challenging task here is how do you ensure the consistency, and how do you ensure the repeatability of these produced parts? That is that's a huge challenge in front of us. So definitely, then as you said, like the failure rate, how it can be reduced. Definitely, I can say until unless the ASTM standards, once it will published, and definitely it is no other go. It's a trial and error only. So like you have to, that too, you must be a good in, there's very sound knowledge in design aspects, design for additive manufacturing. That's what I've been talking about. Say one aspect will be how do you tackle your support structure. So then it's a huge hell of problem in case of support structure, both polymer and metal printing. So then the failure rates, we can even minimize some extent, maybe with the good design for additive manufacturing philosophy and some thumb rules which you can follow. And based on the feature and based on the geometry, we need to do a lot of say practice on that or do a research. Why? Because there is no standards which it is saying that you use this, but each object and each geometry is a challenge. It's a unique, which we need to work out your own optimized parameter, the set of parameters which I am talking about. 180 plus parameters are there. Then how do you optimize these parameters? Out of 180, again, you may have some 10 to 15 predominant parameters that is going to judge your outcome. So, but the thing still, it is the open challenge is like the one solution will be the standardization of these things. That is not happening, but it may take some time to address these kind of challenges. Once you have the standards out, then some extent you can have some reference, then you can do accordingly. And of course, the qualification definitely you need to take as I already said, GE has started their project in 2015, and recently they got certification from FAA, that is the Federal Aviation Authority. So they have given just a clearance of their parts, whatever I discussed the previous engine parts. That so then it's definitely it's a new approach you are using. It like if you have a casting or if you have a machining, there you have a already established standards to test against that. But it is a relatively new technology, and relatively this technology is emerging in the recent times. So it will take some time to stabilize these things. Then, yeah, as of now, no other go. Then we need to have some trial and error, or your research approach, your own experience on using that machine. Why? Because each object, each build is a challenge. You cannot standardize these parameters. So then each one is a different ball game. As you change the geometry, even if you change the orientation of your build, it's altogether it's a different story, which you have to say. Yeah, I hope I have answered your question.
Yeah, I got it. So the one more small doubt is, so during the process, like we can't supply the powder at a time, so we need to recycle the powder in a sieving station. So what is the reusability of powder? Because every time the powder particles will get solidified each other, and the powder particle enormously get increases. So we cannot use the huge powder particles in it. So what is the reusability of powder? And and one more thing, sir, when you are talking like to reduce the failure part. So we have done one experiment on SLM. So where we have built four products on different positions of the build plate. So where we got different results for every product. So yep. even the position also affecting the properties of the product. So in that case, now, sir, so like when comparatively, so we build four products on four corners and one more build on the center. So on the center product, we are getting the better qualities comparatively on the other positions of the. So even the position also affecting the qualities. So in that case, the qualifying of a product and standardizing is a very difficult thing. As of you said that, I understand with it. So one more one last thing, sir. What is the reusability of a powder? How many times we can reuse it?
Yeah. You are from which institute?
ARCA, sir. ARCA Hyderabad.
Yeah, you are from ARCA. Okay, fine.
Yes, sir.
Okay, great. Yeah, actually, coming to the reusability, we have some thumb rules, unscientifically and scientifically also, we have some a sieving. You can sieve it and then. That sieving may not say give you 100% scientific reusability, but you have scientific methods to check the whether the grain particle is have some kind of atlarmas or some kind of thing it got there. And then you can find in the literature there are a good amount of methods, one or two methods available to do a scientific. Scientifically, whether it can be reusable or if it can be done, but in a typical thumb rule or in a typical thing, normally 1/3 will be the reused powder in a thumb rule. What normally 2/3 will be the fresh powder normally, and then this will be the after sieving only you have to use, not directly. Don't use that powder from the. The bed, cake bed, and then we need to sieve it, and then you can add 1/3, and then 2/3. That's vague, or that's a kind of unscientific way, or even you have some particle testing to be done, and then exactly based on that you can segregate your powder, and then you can reuse it. That's the one way of doing it. And coming, as you already said, repeatability, that is a major challenge. But these certification qualification that is done, mostly if you see the certification and qualifications now and the standards, they are application driven standards or qualifications, which you talk about. GE is a player in aviation. So they have a tie up with the ISO and ASTM. And they are developing their qualification as for their application. So then companies like Stryker is a implant manufacturer for medical applications I'm talking about. Say then medical also we need to have the certification for FDA approvals. It should be, and any regulator must be given such kind of certifications of that product using as a implant. So then they have the Stryker or other people, the implant manufacturer. So they have the tie-up or they have the collaboration or user groups, and they are working in that way. But we'll discuss in length tomorrow's, there is one standardization, qualification and certification of the parts. We'll discuss tomorrow elaborately on this. But still, as you already said, it's a challenging one. And then as of now, it is going application wise, this qualification and the certification is going in that way, but not like it will take some time to standardize this. Then only. Yeah.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Any more questions?
Sir, I thank you for your wonderful and memorable speech. Various examples of using the additive manufacturing technology in brackets, in satellites, in chambers. In chamber, we can reduce 80% scrap by fabrication of titanium materials. That is also one of the best example we have to take from you. And we can do a lot of research on this point. And you have given a leak engine example that 20 parts have been assembled in a single part. By increasing the 5% durability of the product by reducing 25 weight, that is also one of the very highlighted point of your from your lecture, sir. And we can use the bio inspiration, the key point which you are mentioning during the exchange, that we can use the bio inspiration and we can create the composite complicated parts in the different various machining equipments and various engines in aerospace industry, sir. Regarding the materials also, sir, we have highlighted all the materials which are useful, which can be applicable for the various departments in the various aerospace. So, however, the seat has to be made with resins, the compartment, the chambers, the jet engines has to be made with titanium, and various materials we have given and the industries where we are using this technology. I once again thank you, sir, for a wonderful and inspirational, memorable speech. I thanks once again.
Yeah, they can mail me or they can reach me.
Doubt,
yeah.
If you have any doubt, you can contact sir directly. Okay. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. Bye. Yeah, thank you. Bye-bye. Bye.